needed. When the rising time has elapsed, dust the kneading surface with some flour, remove the dough from the bowl with a spatula, and transfer it onto the surface. Gently stretch the dough by hand to obtain a flat shape, and then fold the dough into thirds like a letter, so left side end folded first, then the right end over that. Now, fold the dough in thirds again, but this time top to bottom instead of side to side. You can also roll the dough, as Miriam is showing you here. Next, form a sort of smooth ball by grabbing the edges and gently tucking them under the ball, turning as you smooth and round the dough. This is actually easier to show than to explain. Place the dough back into the ball, dust it again with some flour, and cover it with cling film. Let the dough rise for an additional 30 minutes. Once the time has elapsed, transfer the dough into a baking tray lined with greaseproof paper dusted with some flour and gently stretch it into a flat shape. For the sake of being thorough, here we are using a 35 by 25 centimeters oven tray, or 14 by 10 inches if you prefer. Now poke the dough all over with your fingertips to create the traditional focaccia dimples. Take the marinated tomatoes and press them into the focaccia without being too precise, as you want to achieve a rustic final look. You can also preheat the oven to 200 degrees Celsius or 390 degrees Fahrenheit. Also, make sure to drizzle the juices released by the tomatoes randomly over the dough to add extra flavor. Cover the tray with a kitchen towel and leave the dough to rise for the last 30 minutes. Once the time has elapsed, remove the towel and bake the focaccia for 20 minutes. And there you have it. The addition of potatoes to the dough not only makes the final focaccia extremely soft to the bite, but it also helps the yeast to do its magic so that you can have the final product in a nice, short amount of time. After our video for regular pancakes, we wanted to propose a recipe for gluten-free pancakes, as we are aware how difficult it is to make proper food with alternative gluten-free flours. Non-wheat flours react very strangely to both water and cooking, and for this reason, making good gluten-free foods can be a challenge even for the most experienced chefs. To begin with, simply place all the ingredients into a medium-sized bowl and stir to combine them properly. Due to the absence of gluten, we need a substitute to get a batter with the elasticity of a regular pancake batter. I wouldn't recommend using xanthan gum, as it is a pretty nasty ingredient. Not to mention that it can be extremely dangerous if not dissolved properly into the food. For the sake of making healthy recipes, we are not going to use any here. Instead, we are using psyllium husk, which is basically pure natural fiber. Once you have the batter ready, let it rest for 5 minutes so that the psyllium have the time to swell and thicken the batter. Once the time has elapsed, heat the pan over a medium heat and get ready for cooking. If you haven't watched our previous video for pancakes, I strongly suggest you to do so, just to get a better idea about this amazing dish. When the pan is hot, pour in some of the mixture and cook it for roughly 1 minute, or until you see the surface drying completely, as you can see here. Once you've got the first side right, you can flip the pancake over and cook it on the second side for roughly half the time of the first side, or until slightly colored. Once you've done that, you can simply repeat the process until you're out of batter. It is important to mention that gluten-free foods do not react well if left to sit on the kitchen counter for a few hours, as they all tend to become very hard and dry. And here you have the final pancakes. Don't you dare telling me that these pancakes don't look as appetizing and mouth-watering as regular ones.
You guys, this is so much fun. I'm so excited. Can you imagine what's happening in here? Happy, I have lots of good food for you.
All I gotta do is put some butter in my skillet behind me. It attacks your palate, and it's in perfect harmony. Balance between with honey, with sugar, vanilla bean.
So let's go eat.
Thank you for coming.
Okay.
What a beautiful table. What's the occasion, I ask you?
Well, we're here to celebrate our 50th anniversary.
50th wedding anniversary.
Oh, and this signora. Is my daughter.
Incantato, mi permette, guardi. Lei signorina è bellissima.
This table is here for the 50th wedding anniversary. We're going to have to do something special, something enchanting, something unique. You may wonder what? I'll tell you what. We're going to make pasta alla carbonara. And after pasta alla carbonara, we're going to make scallops. Ah, scallops with spinach. It's incredible. It's a simple dish. It takes nothing at all to do it. Is the food good? What good? It's glorious, glorious food. Follow me in the kitchen. Andiamo. Carissimi amici, we have a recipe for you today, pasta alla carbonara, real traditional Italian pasta, often seen at many Italian restaurants. But what I'm going to show you today is how to do it at home in a simple fashion, yet so full of flavor that not only will surprise you, but all the friends and family that you'll have at your dinner table. There's all sorts of stories about this pasta, which I'm going to tell you quite quickly, but before we move on to my story, because, you know, I start telling stories, I forget what's going on. Why don't we look at the ingredients, and then I'll guide you right through it. You ready? Snap into action. What we want to start out with is 4 tablespoons of olive oil, 5 tablespoons of pancetta or bacon, diced, 4 garlic cloves, thickly sliced, 1/4 teaspoon of red pepper flakes, 4 tablespoons of chopped fresh Italian parsley, 3/4 cup of white wine, 3/4 cup of chicken stock, 2 egg yolks, 5 tablespoons of grated pecorino romano cheese, 1/2 teaspoon of black pepper, 1/4 cup of pasta cooking water, and 1 pound of pasta. So here we are. To speed things up, while I was reading to you, I put the olive oil here in the pan. We're going to bring this olive oil to medium heat, and we're going to start by cooking the pancetta. And as the pancetta cooks, I'll tell you a little bit about what pancetta is. You ever wonder where the word pancetta comes from? In Italian, pancia means tummy. The pancetta is the thigh of the pig or the pork. And basically it is exactly like bacon. But unlike bacon, pancetta is not smoked. Pancetta Italian style comes either in a slab or rolled. Mostly in this country we get the rolled kind. And what happens is basically dry cured. There's a great deal of spices, salt and pepper and rosemary, and then each part of Italy has their own way of doing it. The pancetta brings into the sauce a particular flavor. This particular pasta, pasta alla carbonara, translates as pasta of the coal miner. Legend has it that the coal miners of Italy prefer this as their most restorative dish during the lunch break before they go back into work. And I'm telling you, this pasta is fantastic. And after a pasta like this, you could almost have a full lunch by itself. You can really take a very nice glass of red wine or a nice glass of very strong white wine. What we've done with this particular pasta is we're going to be cooking it into a very rich sauce. The sauce first comes from the browning of the pancetta. There's 2 ways in which you can do this. You can chop the pancetta or you can slice the pancetta. But let's assume you don't have any pancetta available where you're from. What could you substitute it with? You can substitute it either with bacon or salt pork. If you use bacon, I would suggest, since bacon is smoked and pancetta is not smoked, if you want to get rid of the smoke flavor of the bacon, is to blanch it quickly in water. Do the same thing with salt pork. Also, if you can, buy fresh bacon and have it cut in a thick slice, and then you dice it up so it looks exactly like the pancetta. The pancetta is now taking place, cooking beautifully. It's at this point, when the pancetta is not completely brown, that I like to add the sliced garlic, the red pepper for a little bit of fiery, and 1/2 of the parsley. Toss this around a little bit. This is going to give you the flavor base that is going to enhance the sauce enormously. Let me give you one more idea what it is that you can do if you don't have pancetta. You can take bacon. You can slice it really thin if you don't want to dice it. Then put it in the refrigerator overnight with a nice grinding of pepper over it.
The pepper will penetrate the bacon. I'm not saying you're going to have pancetta the next day, but you'll have the closest possible thing to it. So nicely sliced bacon, chopped or otherwise, or diced even if you want to, with a nice couple of grinding of pepper on top of it, a little bit of salt. Nah, you know, salt you don't need. Just pepper. Let it sit overnight. The next day, you can act it as far as pancetta. Now, please pay attention to the cooking process right now. You see that the pieces are getting smaller and smaller, and they're getting the kind of browning that we want. The next step that we're going to go with is the deglazing of the wine. Hey, watch for a symphony that's going to take place in front of your very own eyes. Ooh, if you could only smell the aroma that's coming out. The way that this, as the pasta cooks, all these fantastic aromas will just pervade into the air. And only they'll make you happy. The people next door, they'll start knocking on the door. Excuse me, I smell something. Could I come away for lunch or dinner? You're going to make so many friends with this pasta, you won't believe it. Let's move on before I go on with more stories. Here we go with the wine. We add the wine. Very important what to do at this point.
Un dipinto che è basato nella bella funeraria di Elena Duglioli dall'olio, poi la beata è Duglioli, un dipinto nel quale, no, questa meditazione sulla santa soprattrice della musica e sull'idea della musica che capisce e porta oltre la dimensione umana viene svolta però, vedete, in una messa a punto di questo gruppo di figure monumentali, così presenti, così forti nella loro esistenza e nella loro anche, come dire, individualità.
And you'll see the next step that we'll do when we jump the pasta in there with the stellino shuffle, we make it go around like that, and we'll add the egg yolks to thicken up the pasta. A fantastic result. Well, let's bring into the chicken stock and we'll bring it to a boil. This is going to be beautiful. Up to this stage, you see me add no salt and no pepper. And it's very important that we add no salt and no pepper. There's a lot of salt and pepper already in the pancetta. There's a lot of salt and pepper also in the chicken stock, either that's canned or homemade. So wait until the end before you add salt and pepper. And usually with this many ingredients, most of the times, we don't need to. So don't worry about it. Let me take another saucepan that I have over here, in which I basically reduced the pasta almost to sauce consistency. A little bit more. You see now the colors have changed. The pancetta has become much more brown. All the bits that are standing around are flavored bits. You see how much we reduce the stock. This is the consistency that you're looking for. This consistency will caress the pasta as we toss the pasta into it. And then we'll finish it by adding the eggs. Let me move this away from the fire because I don't want it to reduce too much. And let me show you what we're going to do with the eggs. Ah, this is going to be fantastic. Now, here are the eggs. Put the eggs in here. We'll put a little bit of the cheese. A little bit of the pepper, just because I like to make it spicy. And let me show you next what we're going to do. What I like to do at this point is to add some of the water from the cooking pasta. I don't have any pasta in here, but I cook pasta. You hear the rest, and you cook pasta all the time. You add it in here, and then we're going to mix the eggs. Let me show you what we're going to do. Let me clear this area right now. You see? The reason why we do all this, because we don't want to get scrambled eggs. We want to temper the eggs a little bit until we add them at the very end to the pasta to form the beautiful creamy finish, which is typical of pasta alla carbonara. And I think I would like to add a little bit more pasta, water, to give it a looser consistency and temper the eggs a bit more. This is a very important essential step that you have to make in order to have the fantastic result that's typical of a pasta alla carbonara. All right, we're ready to rock and roll, like we say, rock and roll with pasta alla carbonara, coming from you from the rock station Cucina Amore. Okay, I took a little bit of liberty, please forgive me. Here we put it back. Let's move all these little ingredients away. We put them right over here. Pasta. In this case, I've chosen tortelloni, but you can use any pasta you want. My recommendation, if you don't want to go with tortelloni, is rigatoni or penne rigate. Here we are. Let's strain this beautiful pasta. Follow me. We add the pasta to the sauce. Come on, fellas, come out. Ready for a stellino shuffle? Here we go with the shuffling moves. Now, at this point, all that we want to do, we want to absolute cover the pasta, caress the pasta with all the sauce that's left. I'm going to bring the heat to high. Oh, mamma mia, what a mess I made. If my mom would see me, she'd be so upset. She'd never forgive me. All right, let's move this out of the way also. Now, I'm going to finish this particular pasta with the egg trick that I described to you before. Are you ready? Here we have our eggs. I like to cook it a little bit more. The eggs you want to put at the very end, when most of the sauce has been absorbed. And what I like to do is to cook it until I see a little bit more of the sauce totally penetrating the pasta. Mmm, che bontà. Here we go now with the finished pasta. At this point, turn off the heat, because this is going to thicken in front of your very own eyes. Guarda, guarda, guarda il colore come sta cambiando. Don't cook it too much, or else you'll have scrambled eggs. And that's the trick, not to make scrambled eggs, but to make pasta alla carbonara. You see what I do right now? I put the pasta totally away from the heat. Let's pick up a very nice dish that's going to coronate this pasta beautifully. Oh, this is going to be so exciting. Look how rich the pasta looks, the color that it has. And you've seen it come together. It's thick, it's beautiful. Oh, and what I also love to do at this very stage is to add a little bit of parsley, just for color, and, if you allow me, a little bit of cheese. This is beautiful. Pasta alla carbonara made in front of your very own eyes. Please stay with us because I'm going to show you a special dish we're going to make with scallops, capesante, and spinach. Capesante con gli spinaci. You may wonder, what's capesante, Nick? Scallops. Scallops in the northern part of Italy, they are called cappe, C-A-P-P-E, sante. Capesante means holy cap. I have no clue where they came up with this name. Hey, don't ask me, that's just the way they call it. But today, people calling it, they don't use the capesante name. They go, capesante. This is actually the Venetian dialect. Would you like today, Mr. Capesante? So, in Italian, scallops are capesante. In case you don't know what scallops are, scallops, we never see them, but they actually come in a shell like this. The scallop part that we use of the scallop is actually the muscle that opens and closes the shell, because to that propulsion, the shell moves through the bottom of the ocean. Scallops are delicious. In this fantastic mix with spinach, it makes an incredible combination. How did I discover this? Well, let me tell you that later. Let me go into action and let me tell you about the ingredients and then I'll tell you my story. You ready? All right, let's snap into action. Here we go. What we want to have is 5 tablespoons of olive oil, 4 garlic cloves thickly sliced, 1/4 teaspoon of red pepper flake, 1 pound of fresh spinach washed and chopped, 1 juice of 1 lemon, 3/4 teaspoon of salt, 1/4 teaspoon of pepper, 12 large sea scallops, about 3/4 pound, cut in half. 2 tablespoons of chopped shallots, 1/2 cup of white wine, and 2 tablespoons of chopped fresh Italian parsley. So here we are. I'm going to show you what to do. First of all, we want to get the fire going. And I like to start out with about a medium heat. Medium heat, we're going to put the olive oil. We're going to cook the spinach first. The spinach is very important when you get fresh spinach at home, that you wash them really, really well. You can use frozen spinach. My choice in this case would go to go fresh. However, if you don't wash them well, you'll have a lot of grit that's left into the leaves. So do the very best you can. One technique that I found that works extremely well is put them into water and then use the salad spinner. What I've done in this particular case to make your job at home a lot easier is I've roughly chopped the spinach so they'll cook a lot faster. This is fantastic even if you don't chop the spinach. We'll have a bigger chunks of it. I like it a little bit better the way, but you know what? A lot of some people get discouraged because they never see the spinach cooking. I'll show you what happens to the spinach. As soon as they start cooking into the hot oil, they lose most of their volume. So here we add the olive oil to the pan. I'm going to bring this on medium-high heat. To the olive oil, we'll put the garlic, nice garlic, and the red pepper flakes. This is going to make a nice infusion, a base, on which we will cook the spinach. It's very important for you to realize that the flavor of the spinach is going to be combined together with the garlic, together with the red pepper flakes, and then with a little bit of lemon juice that we had that's going to bring everything out, and also the sprinkling of the salt and pepper. Once we cook the spinach, I will put it aside because we have to cook the scallop. It's going to be a very quick recipe. Usually I cook the scallop in the same pan. In this case, just to keep everything separate, and to show you the 2 different stages, I will use a different pan. We'll cook the scallops in there, and then we'll serve in this beautiful dish that I put aside. While the oil is getting really hot, there's a couple of things that I would like to show you. And what I would like to talk to you about is the scallops. Here, let me. I have to be careful. All these ingredients laid out. It's like a masterpiece. It is. It's like a painting. If you don't pay attention to what happens, bada boom! You see, almost fell down. I was watching that thing. It's gonna fall down. No, so I didn't catch it. But look at these beautiful scallops. This is the type of scallops that I like to use. Look how nice and big they are. Let me pick this one up right here. Ah. Look at this gorgeous scallop. This is the muscle that attaches the scallop to the shell. What you want to do is, and I usually encourage this, is to simply rip it off. It's fantastic. Then cut this beautiful scallop in half, like this, and this is the perfect serving size. These scallops are beautiful. Let me put them aside. I have some scallops here that are already cut in half, and let's move on with the cooking of the spinach. Look how hot the oil is now. Oh, see. The oil is ready. So, we have the spinach in here. Put a nice bunch of the spinach in there. What I like to do at this point, this is the best technique. Use these guys. You want to cook the spinach until it basically loses most of this water and it starts flopping down. At this stage of the game, I would like to add the salt and pepper. Reason why now is because the spinach will pick up the salt and pepper. You want to go in a circle, just like this. You want every little grain of salt and every little grain of pepper to really penetrate the spinach. Ooh, guarda che bellezza. And now, what I have in my hand that you'll see right now is a little bit of lemon juice. I'm only cooking portion of the spinach, so we'll just a little touch of the lemon juice. But this is a favorite flavoring agent. Believe it or not, the spinach part is finished. I know, you guys are looking at me like, what, that's it? That's all there is to it. The spinach part is finished. And we will use this spinach together with the scallops. It's a nice combination that goes together. Let's cook now the scallops, though. Let me put the oil right here in the pan. I want to tell you how this dish came about. I would like to tell you they came from my grandma Maria. I would like to tell you they came from my grandma Adele. I would like to even lie a little bit and tell you that was my father Vincenzo that came up with this dish. But no, this dish came to me after a fantastic trip I took in romantic France. Yes, I'm Italian, but I love France. We were in the hills of Normandy, and we were watching a fantastic sunset, a gorgeous sunset just going over the hills. I remember holding my wife's hand and saying to ourselves, this is such a special moment. As we went down the hill into the village right near the ocean, we found out this beautiful little pensione, a French hotel, and we had dinner there. And this was the dish that was served to us. It was absolutely spectacular. We fell in love with it, and I swore since then to try to find the perfect combination to reproduce it for our romantic evenings at home. And now, even though I would like to say I somewhat invented a little bit of things here and there, the dish truly was inspired to me through a romantic trip to France. Hey, what can I tell you? France is beautiful. Now, let's move on with the rest. We have the scallops. Follow me because I want to show you what we do with the scallops. Before you put the scallop on the hot olive oil, put a little bit of the salt and the pepper right on top of it. Just a little bit. We want to cook the scallops very, very quickly. And follow me. Let's wait for the salt to get really, really hot. Because the trick with the scallop here is to just brown them on the bottom and quickly turn them on the other side. And the scallops are finished. There is nothing more that needs to be done. The scallops sont finis, like they say in French. Excuse my French. I really don't speak French that well, but I love the language. It's a fantastic language. Here we are. You ready? Voila. We'll take the first one. Put it right there. A second one. Now, with the scallops, you want to be very careful. You want to cook them very quickly. If you overcook the scallops, you ruin them. If you ruin the scallops, it would really be horrible to do that because they're such beautiful, beautiful pieces of food, and the flavor that they have is so delicious. They're a little bit sweet. The large scallops, I am very insistent, should be the ones to use. If you don't find large scallops, you can use the small ones that you find more commonly. They're called the bay scallops, but the sea scallops are the best choice. Let's cook them a little bit. Now that we have them on the other side, I forgot an important information. You see me put the salt and pepper on that side. Let's put the salt and pepper now on this side. And let's get ready to turn the scallops. I'm gonna cook the scallops just about a minute per side. As these scallops are cooking, I'm gonna take the spinach and I'm gonna start the serving on the dish. Let me show you what I mean. Here we have a fabulous dish on which you're gonna serve our fabulous scallops of spinach. This is what I like to do. This is a single serving. Ah, guardate, guardate che bellezza. Ah. L'odore, che fanno, è bellissimo, favoloso. Our scallops are cooking beautifully. Ah, guardate qua, che bellezza. Ah, che bellezza, che odore, mamma mia. Remember, as the scallops are cooking, they're leaving a lot of the juices into the pan. And we're going to take advantage of these juices, and I'm going to show you how in just a second. Now, we still have here a little bit of the olive oil left. Let's add our fabulous shallots. At this point, we can even add a little bit more of the olive oil, which is what I do. Then, the next thing we want to do is to add the parsley and deglaze it with a little bit of wine. And here we are with the wine. Cook this on very high heat. What we want to do is to reduce this and make a flavoring sauce. Look how the sauce is changing color in front of our very eyes. This is the art. If you want to make the sauce thicker, you can add a couple of pieces of butter and add them right before you add them over there. But you really don't need the butter. The flavor is absolutely fantastic. Believe it or not, we're finished. Now let me show you what we do with this fantastic sauce. Put this away. Carissimi amici, believe it or not, in just a few minutes we made a fantastic dish, capesante con gli spinaci, scallops with spinach. I love this dish. It reminds me of a very romantic moment with my wife, and I hope that maybe when you make it at home, you'll have a little romantic moment for yourself. From my heart to your kitchen, ciao. Ci manca il piccolo dessert. Hey, I have a little surprise for you. I gotta show you this. Che bellezza. Look at this. Bello, eh? Lo so. This is the best dessert for this particular dinner. We started out with the pasta. We then made the scallops. And what we're finishing with is a nice, beautiful glass of strawberry granita. Strawberry granita is very simple to make. It's just fruit, strawberry fruit. Or you can use a puree of fruit, fruit juice, chopped fruit. And you put it together with some water and sugar in the refrigerator for 3 hours. And every 15 minutes, you stir to get this fantastic, fantastic result. Expect just like the coffee granita that I showed you last time. Beautiful, beautiful, absolutely. Look at this. I love this. What we have here is the gorgeous pasta that we made, and we started out with this fantastic pasta alla carbonara, and then we moved on to the scallops, the gorgeous scallops. Did you see that with the spinach? Look at that. Look at how beautiful they are. I love them. Now, remember, people ask me, Nick, what should I start out with? In this particular menu, if it was my own house, and it was me and my wife cooking together a nice romantic meal, which I think this is, I would start out with the pasta because it's nice and strong. I would follow with a completely different taste, which in this particular case is the scallop with the spinach. You could reverse the order. You could do whatever you want. Remember, the pasta does not always have to be first. Italians usually like to have the pasta first. The scallops don't have to be considered an appetizer before the pasta. You can move around as you wish. But my choice, I like to have the pasta and then move on to the scallops and then finish with a very light, a very simple dessert, something that will fulfill your sweet buds, but at the same time keep you light, because this is quite a full meal. What kind of wine should you go with? What I suggest, a nice wine that will compromise all the way through would be a nice, strong Chardonnay. That would make a fantastic mix. Well, this is the part of the show that I like the most. And usually I start out with the pasta, but the scallops, they look so beautiful. I can't resist it. I really have to dive right into it. They were so beautiful. As they were cooking, you know, the most difficult thing about the scallops is how to cook. If you overcook them, if you cook them for too long, they become too tough, and they're not as good as they should be. They lose the sweetness they have naturally. They lose most of the water, the flavoring, the juices. So it's better maybe sometime to undercook the scallop a little bit, and have a bit softer, then overcook it. And, you know, they become so hard. It's like shrimp, you know, you can play basketball with it afterwards. The spinach, the way that I showed you is the simplest way, of course, by roughly chopping the spinach and cooking them together. But the other way that you could do it is also, like I always do at the restaurant, by using the whole leaves and cooking them together. Be very sure when you wash them, the spinach is so full of grit and so unpleasant halfway through your meal, to crunch through, to feel the thing in your mouth. Take the extra time. I know it's a laborious job to do, but somebody's got to do it, and somebody's got to do it right. Hey, let me take a taste, see what this is. I always say, from my heart to your kitchen.
Paese, lei non capiva che in fondo non si vive solo per amore. No.
Why don't we look at the list of ingredients and I'll walk you step by step on how to make it. You ready? Let's snap into action. Remember, to make good food, it doesn't need to be complicated. You don't need any special tools. All you need is an idea, a dream, and a little bit of guts to just go for it. And I know that you can do it. From my heart to your kitchen. Arrivederci. Now let's see how we take this basic springboard idea and see what's on the menu today.
Julia, what are you wearing?
Well, Jack, we're going to have a very hot show today.